A warm welcome to this session, series of conversations and lectures on the theme Art, Life and Waste. There are 8 conversations and lectures as part of this series curated by Riaz Komu. And today we have Sadanand Menon to talk about the topic art production in the age of institutional cop-outs. I think it's a very, very relevant topic, and Sadanand Menon is a very senior, reputed cultural critic, writer, photographer, editor, curator, and has been writing extensively on dance, music, art, and the cultural scene in photography in India, and has been writing in various journals and cultural magazines. And he has been, one thing about, I think, what makes his presence here very, very important is that he has been part of many committees that were set up by the government and other agencies to look at the reformation of cultural institutions in the country. So the basic topic today is about the state of art and cultural institutions in India today. As we know, like, a series of institutions were created in the Nehruvian era with certain kind of vision about India, about culture, about democracy, about life in general. And I think we are going through times when all these ideas, the very idea of India is being challenged. And as part of it, all these institutions, public universities, even public spaces are being, you know, taken over, invaded by communal forces. So I think institutions used to play, like Sahitya Academy, institutions of literature, arts, culture, fine arts, Sangeet Nat Academy, all those institutions created across the country at the central level and also at the state levels, all these regional languages used to play a very, very important role in propagating, encouraging culture on the one side, and also, you know, nourishing and keeping in view the plurality of India, the plural culture of India. That is one of the basic tenets, vision of these institutions. All these are under threat now. And also in the context of the post-CAA protests going on all over the country, there is this whole question about the idea of India, about our pluralism, about our secular fabric of the nation, and about the kind of the way in which these institutions are being threatened and what will be their future is a big question before India today, and the youth all over India are fighting to reclaim, to reassert the democratic fabric of India. So I think Sadanand will be speaking about the cultural institutions, state of cultural institutions in India. He'll be speaking for about 30, 35 minutes, and we'll have a question answer session after that. So over to Sadanand. You have a count there, okay.
Thank you very much, Kerala Literature Festival, Riaz and Vekadi. I think in India we are used to a certain kind of lament, and we have been hearing this across the last 7 decades of our independent existence, how things are collapsing and getting distorted and getting destroyed across time. Institutions that we kind of hold valuable because they are framed within the idea of democracy. We have accepted that we are a democracy, we have accepted that there is a constitution, and we have accepted that to the extent possible, to the extent it is allowed to remain in the basic framework that it consists of, we will remain a democratic country. But I'd like to propose that right from the beginning, right from day one, right from 26 January 1950, and we are coming to the anniversary of that in a few weeks. The idea of democracy got threatened even the way the constitution was framed, because it paid a very cursory attention to the idea of culture. One has to seriously believe that a constitutional structure or a democratic structure can survive, can thrive, and can prosper only when a free and open cultural play is allowed, or there is a space for that. The framers of the Constitution have a very interesting proposition. They say that the Constituent Assembly, the Constitution, the government that will be formed after that, undertakes to look after the socio-political, the economic well-being of the people. You can call them citizens, you can call them whatever, but it undertakes to do that. It's a mandate it gives to itself and to the nation. It also simultaneously proposes that it will look after the cultural well-being of the people. Now, this needed to be defined. I think the economic well-being and political well-being are more or less understood in a certain sense, but what constitutes cultural well-being remains in a gray, shadowy area, remains in a vague area, remains in a fuzzy area, and its parameters were not enunciated in at least a few sentences in the Constitution. With the result, subsequent governments have very conveniently paid lip service to it. Now, for example, the rights guaranteed in Part 3, Article 29, 30 of the Constitution, and the duties expected of the from the citizens in Article 51A, assures that the government will look after the cultural well-being of the people. And in lieu of this, in lieu of certain cabinet decisions taken, it was decided to set up institutions that will look after specific aspects. They were all segmented and segregated. Culture was segmented into visual art, performing art, literary arts, dramatic arts, and so on. It was segmented. It was already split. It was not considered as a totality, but it was considered as a split field and emerged as such in the way the institutions were set up. So you have, by 1952-53, you had the Sangeet Natak Academy and the Sahitya Academy coming up first, followed by the Lalit Kala Academy for the visual arts. Already you can see a groping in the dark. The Sangeet Natak Academy creates in the year 1956 something called the Drama Seminar, in which anybody in the performing arts in India from across the country, all the well-known names, everybody was invited. And it was not just only theater, but also dancers and musicians, and across the country about 88 delegates under the chairmanship of P.V. Rajamannar and the stewardship of Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay. They invite all these people to figure out what should this institution do, what should the Sangeet Natak Academy do, what will be the brief of the Sahitya Academy, what will the Lalit Kala Academy do, etc., etc. The focus was on the performing arts here because it was a seminar convened by the Sangeet Natak. And as it turns out, they had 80 different proposals. Nobody had any particular clarity on which way to go. And the person who spoke with the greatest amount of persuasive force won the day. And that happened to be a gentleman from Madras called V. Raghavan, who was the one of the founders of the Madras Music Academy, a great scholar, a Sanskrit Pandit, and all he needed to do was to quote a few Sanskrit shlokas, and the entire audience cowed out before that Sanskritism, and this became, you know, the higher culture, the Margi culture became the yardstick by which things will be figured out. Only one thing, good thing came out of it. You had Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay who proposed that within a few years, every state capital in India should have a venue for performance. The government should create a venue. And this was implemented, and by the year 1960, we have almost in every state capital, the Rabindra Kalakshetras or the Tagore Theatres. There's one in Trivandrum also. Every capital except in Madras, because Tamil Nadu already was asking for secession. Tamil Nadu did not want to be part of the Indian mainstream. The Dravidian movement was saying that we are a separate nation, and we do not want anything from the center. No central Sangeet Natak Academy, no central Lalit Kala. They just poo-pooed that idea. So Madras till today does not have a Tagore Theatre or a Rabindra Theatre. But every other state capital in India has one, including Srinagar. Now, this was, by 1960, this has come up. By 1962, the National School of Drama has been set up. Another year down the line, the Film and Television Institute comes up. By 1960, the National Gallery of Modern Art starts with a collection donated by the Shergill family, Amrita Shergill's works. The National Museum has come up just a little while before, a few years before. So all this happening in the 1950s, where institution after institution is being created. But like I said, this happening in a fuzzy space. It's a space of this Achhe Din kind of thing, you know, like let's do something good. It's a benevolent patron who wants to create benevolence in the among the citizenry and imagines that if you create these kind of institutions, automatically the cultural goods will rise. However, in the absence of a clearly thought out cultural policy, and I won't even go to cultural policy, but just an arts policy, a simple arts policy, which every other developed nation in the world engages with. An arts policy is considered a crucial device for looking at how to promote the arts in the country, how to integrate new developments, how to promote research, how to expand the levels of education and pedagogy, how to create new spaces, and so on and so forth, how to increase the field. However, India has been remiss in that. The Indian lawmakers have been remiss in that. We have never ever tried formulating an arts policy. One or two attempts that were made were very feeble, somewhere in the 1990s, and they were abandoned as soon as they were almost started. So, as these institutions start, everything is ad hoc. What should a Sangeet Natak Academy be doing? First of all, what does Sangeet Natak comprise of? We don't know. Lalit Kala Academy, what are the Lalit Kalas? Is it modern art? Is it medieval art? Is it folk art? Is it tribal art? All kind of categories come up and they are jousting with each other. They're conflicting with each other. We don't know. The institutions don't know which way to go. At least during those days, there were very important people, very important artists, very well-known, celebrated senior artists who were at the helm of these institutions. So not too many questions were asked because they had the ballast, they had the power to, you know, keep these institutions afloat and hold it together. But even as we are coming to the year, something like 1964, the conversation, the noise around the irrelevance of the academy has become so much that the government is forced to appoint a committee to look into the affairs of these organizations. And that time it was called the Homi Bhabha Committee, 1964. Homi Bhava, very, very conscientious man, understands the field, understands performing arts, understands visual arts, etc., etc. And he comes up with a 34-page document on how to make these academies a little bit better and perform better. Inevitably, and I don't have to say this, but I'm sure everybody here knows what the fate of these reports would be, it's put on a shelf and it's covered with dust in a few years and nothing moves. Another 10 years down the line, again the commotion builds up, oh, what is going on, all our academies are going to the dogs, what shall we do? So they set up another committee. This time it is Justice G.D. Khosla, a very revered and very learned justice, who again also brought out one of the first documents on censorship in India and the possibility of allowing nudity in cinema. So he's a very liberal person, and he looked at the previous report, the Homi Bhabha report, and he said, "Arey, all that I want to say is already said in this report. Anyway, let me add 10 more pages." So he produces a 50-page report called the Justice Khosla report. Another few years, 10 years down the line, 1989, again, this time the noise is growing more and more. It's post-emergency, and people are saying, look, the country is going to the dogs, and the arts are going to the dogs, and no support systems, etc., etc. So another committee is constituted. This time, the committee of people, many of whom are still alive, Ghulam Sheikh was in it, Ibrahim Al-Qazi was in it, etc., etc. But this was headed by the well-known bureaucrat P.N. Huxer. And it is popularly known as the Huxer Committee Report, a very expansive report. It's a 98-page document which goes into every aspect of creating institutions and the rationale for these institutions. Why should they be? What should they be doing? How do you? And he also actually analyzed by inviting members and office bearers of every academy to this committee to interrogate them and find out what exactly is going around. Why is the president of a society or a chairman of an academy fighting with the secretary? What is going on? What is wrong? Because this became a pattern. No chairman could get along with no secretary, and it became like a continuing drama that was going on. Anyway, the Huxer Committee report is very elaborate, and he proposes lots of pretty stringent measures to be taken immediately by the government so that all these committees could be rectified and revived in a manner that would be useful to a growing democracy. At that time, we are just before the liberalization of the economy, everybody is sensing something in the air, everybody knows that the market is knocking at the doors, and everybody knows that a state intervention in the arts production and in the arts sustainability is a very important issue in a democracy. And there is a pressure on the government to implement some of these recommendations. Soon after that, the National School of Drama started having enormous amounts of trouble. And to look into it, another committee was set up called the Girish Karnad Committee in 1998. And Girish Karnad, of course, distinguished person, theatre person, writer, etc. And he made some very special proposals. But that also went on the shelf. A few years down the line, came a committee in the year 2005, which is called the Broad-Based Committee, because the Girish Karnad Committee's report was not implemented. The NSD went into a further collapse, and a broad-based committee, this time comprising of 35 people, many of them from the alumni of the NSD itself, and non-teaching staff and teaching staff, and everybody was invited. And I happened to be also on that committee, and I drafted a 94-page report on what could be done with the idea of National School of Drama, the idea of theatre training in India, etc., etc. The idea of integrating modern theatre with all the other kinds of vernacular theatres that exist all over the country. that too went on the burner. Then in 2009, there was a big commotion in Lalit Kala Academy. Like I said, the chairman and the secretary were at loggerheads and nothing could move forward. So a bureaucrat called Subramaniam was invited to study this and put out another report. The Subramaniam report was half done because Subramaniam abandoned the project, saying that, "I'm sorry, this is beyond me. I'm only an IAS officer. I can't deal with these artists." And he abandoned it. And within the next year, by 2010, another committee, another group led by the artist Krishan Khanna, very, very distinguished, very senior artist, that was set up. And he produced a report which kind of echoed what the Haksar Committee report was saying. And that again went on to the back burner. 2 years later, Manishankar Iyer was invited to look at what is going wrong with the zonal cultural centers. That is a Government of India initiative. And the zonal cultural centers were also going to the dogs. And nobody knew the rationale for the zonal cultural centers. And they had very, very poor budgets and very poor staff and extremely unqualified professionals who were or non-professionals who were invited to run it. So Manishankar Iyer, of course, in his inimitable style, had only one solution: shut it down, which of course was not done, and the report was again shelved. Then cumulatively, like these things were building up cumulatively, and eventually in the year 2013, the parliament began to take notice of this. And a parliamentary committee under the leadership of Sitaram Yechuri, the CPM member of parliament, was set up to look at, which had members from both the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, to examine what exactly was going wrong. And Sitaram Yechuri took this a bit seriously. And somewhat like the Haksar Committee's investigation, he invited a large number of artists, visual artists, performing artists, writers, etc., to come and depose before this committee and explain to the committee what was going wrong. And Sitaram Yechuri's that report, it's called the Parliamentary Standing Committee Report on Functioning of National Academies and Other Cultural Institutions. And by the way, this was the 201st report. Before this, there had been 200 reports submitted to the parliament on what was going wrong with the academy. So it's been a crisis situation for a long time, and obviously nobody had paid attention. So this report, and it's a detailed report, it's supposed to be a document that is not available in public. I have somehow managed to get a copy. I'll read out some of the elements in it, which Sitaram Yechuri is pointing out. For example, at one place, the committee's report says, "The committee feels that the entire field of art and culture did not get the required attention for decades, despite the foresight and commitment of the founding fathers, who knew the significance of arts and culture in the process of nation building." That's what the report says. I would like to argue that, in fact, they did not take the idea of nation building and culture and arts very seriously. It was just seen as a decorative thing. After all, artists are just people who entertain you. So it was a kind of decorative approach. It's a way of, gilding the lily sort of attitude. And it was taken very lackadaisically. So that was kind of problem number one. And so based on some of the things that Yechuri and friends were saying, I'll read some more things. In some places, they are pretty strong. They say, for example, "The committee found that the secretariat of these cultural institutions were manned by people who have little idea or knowledge about how to manage the arts and culture. Many of them lack professionalism required for the field. The committee feels that a cultural cadre distinct from the regular administrative cadre needs to be created to man the functioning of the academies, museums, and other cultural institutions." So It's a pretty strong recommendation. And it's a pretty strong condemnation of the fact that we don't have professional people enough. Somewhere around this time, I was taken into to be on the advisory board of the National Museum. And the very first issue that was placed before us in the National Museum was the fact that the National Museum, which comprehensively looks after 71 museums all over India, including the Indian Museum in Calcutta, it lacks 1,474 personnel across these 71 museums all over India. And this includes in Delhi itself, for example, there was no director general, there was no deputy director, there was no associate director, there was no curator, there was no numismatist, etc. Down the line, there were 38 vacancies in Delhi alone. And when we set out to try and fill these vacancies, it became very clear that while, and this is why I'm saying the founding fathers did not think seriously about this, because to be a curator of a museum, a gallery in a museum, the National Museum in Delhi has 17 galleries, out of which even today, 7 galleries are shut because there are no curators for those galleries. The Central Asian Museum, no curator for it, shut. It's locked, there's a seal, you know, red wax seal on it. The Chola Bronzes section, shut. There's no curator for it. And so on and so forth. There are 7 galleries that are shut, and they've been shut for over 20 years now because there are no curators. Now, where will these curators, where will these trained people come from? The epigraphists, the curators, the numismatists, and so on. They will come only if the Indian universities start courses for them. Cumulatively, all over India, there are only 2 universities that have courses in museology. There is the Baroda Museum, there is the Banaras Hindu University. And then there's a National Museum's own course, which takes in 12 people every year, gives them a 2-year program, postgraduate program. And every one of these 12, once they graduate, they go abroad. They get jobs abroad. They don't stay back in India. So Indian museums willy-nilly do not have personal, professionally trained personnel who can handle the museums. And it became a crisis. So anyway, the Sitaram Yechury Committee, there are many such paragraphs in that report, which I will not trouble you with, but they eventually said, we must form a high power committee, a very nice pompous sounding name. A high power committee should be set up, which will go into all these academies all over again and produce a report. So, and they gave them 3 months. So in the month of January 2014, this committee is constituted, headed by a former secretary of culture in the Ministry of Culture in Delhi, Abhijit Sengupta. And he forms a small team of 6 people, and they go into this. And again, the joke is, in every, it's a much more voluminous report. It's about almost 200 pages, that report. In virtually every clause, they are saying, this has been said before. This has, it's almost like reading Mahabharatam or Ramayana. It's like, this has been said before. Somebody has said this before. And almost everybody is quoting the Aksar Committee report. So the whole charade is repeated again. And the poor committee, they produced a very good, very voluminous report in the month of, they gave the report to the government in the month of April 2014. By May, the government has changed. You have our own dear government now at the center, whom all of us are supposed to love more than we love our mothers or whatever. And the committee, the report was immediately shelved. Nobody wanted this. And in fact, now they've done the opposite. Now if you look at this, what's happening in Sangeet Natak and Lalit Kala and Sahitya Academy and National School of Drama and all that, they handpick. There's no governing council, there is no executive committee, there is no, none of that. IAS officer handles, a joint secretary in the Ministry of Culture handles all these academies. They handpick someone who has some connection with the RSS or VHP to come and sit and occupy a chair there. and they don't need to. It's a bit like the vice chancellor in Jawaharlal Nehru University. They don't need any particular qualification or any particular distinction. All they need to be able to do is to block anybody else from coming in, block any progressive thought from coming, block any development that might happen, block any, a leap that the art in India might take. So we are in that very strange position today. The question would be, why is the artistic community not responding to this? I think that's fairly clear, because post 1991 and post liberalization, the arts, particularly the visual arts and music, have come into money through the private sector. There's been a boom in galleries, there's been a boom in auctions, and the painters, sculptors, installation artists of India have had a fairly good innings after that. And they do not need the Lalit Kala Academy anymore. And probably they're not even concerned. As far as they're concerned, a government institution that looks after or oversees visual art in India is an anachronism, because they only produce do's and don'ts and all kinds of strange antediluvian laws. So it's much better for them that they are independent of these academies. So today, even if you invite some of the well-known senior artists or even the younger artists to come and be on these committees, they will just decline, and they'll say it's a waste of our time. In the Sahitya Academy, again, similar situation has happened. The market has boomed, and writers are finding either they're self-publishing or they're finding new publishing houses which can take their work on, and the online process has also taken on, and that's become much more viable for a writer today to survive without the academy. The Sangeet Natak Academy is the only place where there is a tussle for some sort of capture, because Sangeet Natak Academy, right from the beginning, has been dealing mostly with classical arts. And the classical arts in India today have willy-nilly, without anybody inviting them, they have aligned themselves with the ruling powers that be, because they see no difference between being Indian, being Hindu, talking mythology in their dance and music and so on. They're just, copped out into this. And it's become a very, useful space for them to vie for awards. So this year, I gave my friend Vengati an award. Next year, he becomes the secretary there. He gives me an award, and that it goes on like that. So everybody's happy. I'm happy, you are happy, kind of thing. It goes on in a jolly way. So now, I think if cumulatively this is spoken in the manner that I have spoken now, it will sound like a lament. It will sound like I'm crying, nothing is happening, that sort of thing. But the point is, nothing will happen. It's been designed to fail. The entire academy structure, the entire institutional structure of the arts in India has been designed to fail, so that the artist is permanently obliged to the government. And it cannot take off until and unless somebody shows courage, and I'm sure that courage will not be there in this regime, the present regime at the center, but that courage has to come to actually devise an arts policy where you openly say that the arts of the country has to be aligned to the aspirations of the people of the country, where the artists have to be given these platforms, given these opportunities to deal with issues that are plaguing Indian arts for a long time. For example, the issue of casteism in Carnatic music, in dance, Bharatanatyam, etc. You encounter this casteism on a day-to-day basis. In the visual arts too. people who come out of the Adivasi belt are called tribal artists, and you create a separate museum for them, you create a separate academy for them. It's all segmenting and putting them away. And unless a comprehensive art policy emerges, a political and a progressive arts policy emerges, lamenting on the failure of the institutions I think would be counterproductive. But one needs, nevertheless, an activist artistic community to handle this head-on, to handle this in a manner that will produce at least some frisson at the end of the road. At the moment, it's very dormant. There's nothing happening. But right from the earliest of governments, it was seen to it that the arts were the least funded of the departments in the ministries. So for a long time, there was no Ministry of Culture. It was only a Department of Culture within the Ministry of Education. Then later on, it became a Department of Culture within the Human Resource Development Ministry. So only recently that's emerged as a ministry of its own in the last maybe 10, 15 years. But right from the beginning and even till today, in the year 1952, the budget allocated for cultural institutions by the Corpus Fund of India was 0.12% of the GDP. Today, 2021, the budget available is 0.13%. 0.01% increase, fantastic, we should all clap. But this is you look at the United Kingdom is 7.6%. You look at the United States, 6.4% of their GDP. You look at Australia, 14.4%. So that's the way those countries look at what needs to be done for art and culture. Whereas we here remain in a very strange situation where we talk about culture, we talk about our great culture, we talk about our great past, but nobody has the courage to bell the cat and to take it forward. So I'll stop it here. I'm sure the audience is small enough for us to have a conversation if people have questions and comments. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sadanand, for a very panoramic view of the way institutions, art institutions, have degenerated through time. And as you say, it has been designed to fail, in a sense. Despite the fact that institutions were created in the 50s and 60s with great lot of vision, and in all departments of arts, that it be literature, performing arts, fine arts, cinema, and all that. Two or three immediate questions. One is this: if you look at the scene of the art academy scene, or these. You can see certain individuals making a difference. Well, there was a structure there which is dormant in a big way, but still you had certain kind of resources and certain individuals could have made changes. For instance, Anandamurthy in NBT, or Sachi in Sahitya Academy, or Kundu in Films Division. They could actually make a change, given the kind of a team with a commitment, could actually work around the institution to create certain results. Do you think it has become impossible? It has gone worse? The system has actually, is almost shut down to such initiatives?
Yeah, that's it's a question that would always come up, whether individuals can make a difference. And I would say yes, individuals can make a difference. I mean, I'm hats off to Sachi for sticking on at Sahitya Academy for so long against so many odds. And fighting those incredible bullies out there in the mafia in Delhi and so on and so forth. It's a daily fight. And those who want to do that fight, yeah, certainly, they can do it. But I'll tell you an anecdote. When Anantamurthy was there.
NBT?
No, Sahitya Academy. 1993. That's when... Our A.K. Ramanujan passed away, and I was working those days as an arts editor with the Economic Times, and Anantamurthy had been to Delhi about 2 months before that for a seminar in the Indian International Center, and a very good writer, journalist from the Times of India called Ayesha Kagal had done a longish interview with him. And she had come and offered that interview to me, saying that I work with Times of India. Times of India doesn't have that kind of space, but you have much more space in Economic Times. Whenever you get a chance, you can use this. I'll leave it with you. And 2 days later, an excellent photographer from Bombay called Ketaki Sheth had come, who had also been there at that time and had taken some very good pictures of Anantamurthy. So she had also given it to me, saying, Aisha told me she has given you your article, so I'll give you the photographs. Whenever you're using it, you can use both together. And lo and behold, two months later, we get this news that Anantamurthy has passed away. So A.K. Ramanujan has passed away. So I called all my team, my juniors and sub-editors and all that, and I said, look, we'll produce a tribute page for Ramanujan. He's a very, very important personality. We'll do a full page tribute. We'll use Aisha's interview. We'll use the photographs. And we started laying out, working with a designer, etc. But by afternoon, it turned out that there were some biographical details needed, which I didn't remember top of the head. But I had that material with me at home. But that my home at that time in Delhi was 1.5 hours by motorcycle. I had to reach home and come back. So I thought, instead of wasting my time going up and down like that, I'll go do the next best thing. I called the Sahitya Academy and I said, do you have material on A.K. Ramanujan? So the librarian, again someone whom I knew quite well, I could almost see him standing up on the other end of the phone saying, sir, you're the first journalist to call. Yeah, it's a great loss to the nation. It's terrible, you know, please come, I'll give you all the material. So I hopped onto my bike. Within 5 minutes, I was at the Sahitya Academy office. He was waiting at the door to receive me. He made me sit on his own chair, and very ceremoniously, he walked to the 10 steps and opened out a filing cabinet, pulled out I could see from that distance, a pink file with blue felt pen titled A.K. Ramanujan written on it. And then he came and offered that file to me very, very ceremoniously. I opened the file. There was not a scrap of paper in it. Not a scrap of paper. So equally ceremoniously, I closed the file and I gave it back to him. And I said, Mr. Bengare, tomorrow morning my page will come in Economic Times. I'll come and gift it to you. Gift it to you. You don't have to buy Economic Times. I'll gift it to you. After that, start your fucking file. Now, the best known people are on top, but the system is such that, like I said, it's designed to fail. The archive doesn't work. Sangeet Natak Academy has done lots of archival recordings of my close friend Chandralekha. After she passed away in 2006, now it's 13 years, every year I send them a message, can I get some videos of her thing? And every year they send a polite letter, yes, sir, we are searching for it. They've still not found it. So it's that kind of thing. They spend a lot of money. There's a fantastic documentation unit, archive unit, this, that. But it's a non-functioning thing. The library is non-functioning. This High Power Committee report, Huxer Committee report, they all point out that all these academies have libraries, Sahitya Academy particularly so, but there's no space. So you need to actually take it seriously and take it to another space where you believe that the library will go into 20 years, you have that kind of, expansive space and create those kind of facilities for Xeroxing, for transmitting, for online transmission, etc., etc. But we are very happy remaining in that little frog in the well kind of thing.
Yeah, also like largely you are talking about national academies. Is there any difference in the state level, regional level academies? Is it the same kind of affairs?
State level, I must say, there are only two state level academies that have shown that the states can be better than the center. And that is the Kerala State Lalit Kala and Sangeet Natak Academies, and the Sahitya Academy, and the Chandigarh, for some reason, Chandigarh. These two state academies have shown that, again, only it just needs one or two people. It just needs the right people at the right person at the right time. And everything blooms and everything goes. But everybody has a term of office, 3 years, 5 years. You can extend it by another 3 years if you want. But once that so-called excellent person goes and the next person comes, the whole thing is designed to collapse back into non-activity. And so this one person who's doing it is doing it against the grain in one sense. It's because you have little more clarity, you probably have a little more experience in the field, you probably have a better vision, etc., etc. The high power committee report, this 200-page report, virtually in every page is saying for every single institution that a vision statement must be demanded. Lalit Kala Academy should have vision statements. Sahitya Academy should have vision statement. Film and Television Institute should have vision statement. So we are talking about institutions that don't have vision statements. So it's like a scandal, actually.
Also, like, if you look at the post-90s situation, like, even while state has retreated from culture in a large way after this globalization and all that, you see the rise of a lot of other initiatives. Like, we have huge literary festivals all over the country, like Jaipur, Chennai, or Kerala here. And you have institutions like Biennales coming up. So how do you look at it, actually? Are these initiatives actually filling in a kind of gap between state and the market, or is it going to be again market-driven in a large way?
No, inevitably, when these kind of enterprises emerge, when these kind of festivals emerge, and they are now plenty all over the country, and in literature, in cinema, in visual arts, it's growing. There's also photography coming in Chennai, Photo Biennale, etc. Orissa, amazing state. Orissa, every day there are three festivals going on. Every day, three festivals. Orissa state is investing so much in the arts, it's not a joke. And they're, of course, tying it with tourism. But they're opening out all kind of frontiers there. But all these private initiatives towards creating biennales and all that are coming because of the failure of the academies. The failure of the public institutions. The Lalit Kala Academy had constituted a triennale. It was way back in the 1960s, and at that time, the first Indian triennale was the second ever triennale to happen anywhere in the world. The first one was in Cuba, in Havana, and the next one was in New Delhi. Imagine, we were way ahead at that point. No other country anywhere had even imagined a triennale. The triennale lasted, so it's once in 3 years, and it lasted for 6 editions. By the time the 7th edition came, all kind of controversies arose, it kind of didn't happen. And from that point on till now, it has never happened. So for the last 22 years, we have not had a triennale. But until then, we had 6 triennales. Now, the fact that such spaces are needed, spaces that challenge you, spaces that ask questions, spaces that are critical spaces for artists, is what compels eventually the emergence of a Kochi Biennale or the other kind of art events that you're seeing everywhere, or the literary festivals. Obviously, the state can't afford to match this, but the inclusivity of these events, which are private run or private sponsored, will constantly be challenged. The thing about a state-run festival is the fact that you can demand inclusivity, you can demand representation. So the fact that the Biennale here is supported partly by the state also makes the state able to make its own little caveat that, okay, include some marginalized segment, include some political space, etc., etc. And I mean, one of the initiatives that is sitting here, Mr. M.A. Baby, and it is very important for those kind of individuals to come forward and even after they are out of office to continue this campaign. To the need for sustaining these spaces becomes very important. Otherwise, like the Jaipur Literary Festival, it becomes like a big carnival, and in the carnival, many things are lost. Of course, everybody has fun. I buy my ticket, I go there, I have 3 days of great fun. I have my popcorn and I have my ice cream and all that. It's great fun. But if you begin to look at the curation, then all sorts of holes begin to pop up. And we had the Chennai Photo Biennale last year. Same thing happened. It was sponsored by the private enterprise, and it was very difficult to make curators look at the need for inclusivity. And this is a issue that will keep coming up in these kind of spaces. But one is always happy about the possibility of the field expanding, and I'm very happy that all this, you know, diversity and multiplicity of activities going on. There's no doubt about that. But we still need that essential space for discourse. You need to have space where ideas can be contested and jousted, not just through arguments and words, but also through work. And that kind of work certainly is happening in India at a more rapid pace today. And I think it's very important to be able to pull that in. And therefore, this question will keep on coming up. Should the state be in the arts? Is it the business of the government to be in the arts? The important question. There are many people who will say, no, the government should not interfere in the arts, because the government comes with do's and don'ts. The government comes with censorship. The government says, don't criticize us. The government says, if you make an installation of a cow here, you'll shut down this festival or this exhibition, etc., etc. But it seems to be that only in a representative democracy, a government can be persuaded to be able to have that kind of plurality and multiplicity in any kind of curated space. Because if I'm a private actor, if I'm a private sponsor, I can say I want only a festival which showcases Saffron and nothing else. And there's no argument against it. It just happens like that. And there'll be a public for it, and there'll be an audience for it, and so on and so forth. So I'm of the opinion that it's the business of the government to be in arts and culture, and it's a business of everybody else to make them accountable, to make them kind of fall in line and sort of put their house in order and get this business going. Because otherwise you are letting the government off the hook. It's very easy. I remember from the year 1994 onwards, and I used to be in Delhi those days, and after that, everybody till the year 2015, so 1994, 2015, that's 20 years, I have interacted with every single secretary of culture in the Ministry of Culture in Delhi. Meaning one meets them in either these kind of spaces or in social gatherings. But every one of them, every sequence from BP Singh onwards, Ashok Vajpayee, then one by one, secretaries of culture, everyone without fail has told me, whenever this kind of question is asked, that, you know, the academies are not working, this, that, why can't you do something? Their reply has been consistently, don't come to us for culture. A, we don't have money. B, we don't have the expertise. And C, we don't have the interest. So don't come to us. Go to the private sector. They say this openly. Go to the private sector. So it's very easy for the government to push it away like this. But I think a responsible citizenry will have to pull it back into that space.
You will take some questions from the audience. Mike, there.
Sadananda, you were saying that there is no point in lamenting anymore. I worked for more than 10 years in All India Radio's Central Archives, which has almost 28,000 hours of Indian classical music. And similar the case of, as what exactly you said about Sangeet Nad Academy is very precious recordings in their archive. Now I will take only these Olinja Radio and Doordarshan's archives as a specimen. You know, I am also going to lament, but you know, what can we do? You know, I Riaz is also here, comrade Baby is here. You know, how can we take at least something? Whether we can take a further step from this particular festival, some sort of a step. You know, I will take the example of Prasar Bharati. Prasar Bharati is doomed. Prasar Bharati is almost over. All the radio stations, all the Doordarshans are being run by technicians, engineers, and the people from other services, and the programming cadre is almost dead in that organization. And Central Archives of All India Radio, I personally know that there are more than 85 hours of recordings of Ustad Amir Khan, more than 180 hours of Pandit Kumar Gandharv. Take the Bhuban Hazarigas lying in Guwahati. Take the example of old Rabindra Sangeet lying in Calcutta. Take the Trichy, one of the richest archive of All India Radio is the Trichy, which has 9 hours of Todi of T.N. Rajinathan Pillai is lying there. But all these analog recordings are gone because no AC as per international standards, you know, then digitization is not done properly. When the technology was available to everybody, the people thought that anyone can digitize Indian music, which was the most rubbish thing that could happen to Indian music. But what is happening with the rich, very rich music archives of under the government sector, whether it is Sangeet Nad Academy or whether it is AIA, and when the organizations are dying, Prasar Bharati is dying, but what will happen to this rich archive? A cultural body like this, whether we can do something, you know, take some sort of an initiative from here, you know, a shelved archive is a dead archive. If people have no access to an archive, it is a dead archive. And all these archives are dead. As you said, you know, I know the Kudiyattam, these Tolpavakoot recordings, which is lying in Sangeetayan Academy, the family wanted to have a copy of it to teach them, but the academy is not giving. Then, therefore, suppose if we stop lamenting, then what can we do as a cultural body? And you know, from whether the curation, the theme is made as art, waste, and music. Therefore, how can we stop making the entire archive as a waste? You know, whether we can, as a forum, we can ask the curated theme, whether we can have some step forward to make the archives under the government departments more accessible. And I won't mind, you said that, you know, private sector should not come into it. Under government supervision, if some private people are ready to, for the way Humayun's tomb is renovated by Aga Khan Trust, at least something is done there. No, it is music, whether this music can be taken to the music departments or whether at least the digitization is again revised, refined, what is happening with analog tapes, whether the central the archives can be given at least 24 hours ACs, you know, I know it is as a lamentation, but I say it with a, you know, deep wound and pain, because I know it is dying.
No, I agree completely. I mean, your pain you've been expressing for a long time, and it's time to create some kind of a citizens' initiative, either through a private enterprise or through well-meaning people within the bureaucracy, etc., to address this in some way. When we know that there's a treasure lying there, you cannot simply allow it to lie there, because it will deteriorate. Like you say, all analog will become powder, and if it's not digitized fast, and if it's not made accessible to an interested population, and there's certainly a very large interested population today. So It has to be a proactive citizens initiative which puts pressure through whatever social media channels or whatever on the powers that be to give access to it. There's absolutely no other way to handle this at the moment. Because the government is sitting on it like a cobra sits on its jewels. You know, they don't come out of that, they don't move out of that, and they don't do anything also. So it's a no-win situation here. But I do believe that there is a scope for example, producing several. Doordarshan has started putting out many of their central production center documentations on YouTube now. Voluntarily, they're doing it. Until now, they were selling it VHS tapes, 5,000 rupees for a tape. But now they're voluntarily putting it on YouTube. So that's a good move.
Very bad quality.
Bad quality also, but the recordings he's talking about are very, very good quality. So if they can put bad quality on YouTube, they can also put good quality. But it needs a push from.
The 1950s and 1960s recordings of All India Radio Trichy, I got an opportunity to listen to many of the recordings there. Amazing recording. You know, there was no stereo recording systems. They had only two or three microphones. But the musicians who were in the studios who balanced the recording and all. And, you know, one of the best recordings are lying in AIR Trichy. But it's so sad, no? No one is there to address these issues. What do you say?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, for example, Pakistan Television has been putting their 1950s recordings of Iqbal Banu and all that on YouTube now. Fantastic, mind-blowing stuff. Informally shot. You wonder how they produce such good audio quality because the camera is informal, the recording system is informal. And it's always recorded in a group of poets sitting, Ahmed Faraz, they're all sitting around. And the quality turns out to be amazing, mind-blowing. You can't do it with the digital, that quality. So there has to be a way of, either we say All India Radio's dead, and therefore we'll create a different radio space. As many of my friends are doing, they're getting into community radio and FM stations, and they're doing something else. But if we need this material, we'll need to put pressure, definitely, there's no other way.
I think we have run out of time. Thank you for being here, and also I think we have to take this discussion forward. I think this series of talks will, I think,